For of him and through him and for him are all things. To him be glory forever. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. So of course, in many ways, last year was much easier since we just did the Gospels. And that's just a story. Of course, this year, by doing the epistles, we go further into the explanations of that Gospel. And sometimes quite abstractly. And this Gospel of this week for the Feast of the Holy Trinity finishes with this magnificent doxology. That all things are from him, and through him, and unto him. That Trinitarian aspect of the richness of the single person, or the single God who we worship and adore, who has appeared among us in the person of Jesus Christ. This gospel also finishes, this epistle today finishes with this great doxology, not only of the glory of the profound Trinity, but also the diversity of person, which is the single one God, desires to bring into oneness all of the human race in the work of redemption. It's what in the anaphora we continually make reference to as the plan of salvation. This is the term we're using in English in this translation, plan of salvation. But the actual term is economia, the way in which God has by his providence directed the human race. And if you notice also what's in this epistle today, in chapter 11 to the Romans, it's echoing 3 weeks ago. And we mentioned the question of the Romans were, now that it's been 25 years since our Lord's glorification, and if Israel was meant to prepare for the coming of the Messiah, why have they not, as a nation, obviously thousands of Jews had received the gospel, but why is it that Israel as a whole have not entered and received the gospel? And it is a great mystery. And so what St. Paul is doing in this chapter 9, at the beginning that we had a few weeks ago, and especially in chapter 10, and the first part of this chapter 11, he's explaining the vision of really the history of mankind. So that what he winds up saying is, kind of in a nutshell, is that humanity is one. There is one father, one mother, and an origin. We know this even genetically today by studying DNA. There is one human race, and the human race in its origin was wounded by its choice. And we go along generation to generation. And God allowed that human race to go by their freedom, which they insisted upon, making their own choices and continuing throughout their history. And at about 3,500 years ago from us, 1,500 years before, and 2,000 years before St. Paul, begins this history by calling out Abraham. One man whose family were pagans, they worshipped idols. And he began to prepare this man's family. But that story goes on for another 5 centuries. And winds up forming a people, the descendants from this man, centuries later, being melded into a single identity by the slavery in Egypt. And when they had been pounded on for generations, God said, all right, this is enough. And he brings them out of that mortar, out of that pestle, and he brings them out to Mount Sinai, and he begins to teach them. And this is the formation of Israel, Yisrael, the children of Jacob. And he forms them in order to educate them while the rest, the Greeks, the Romans, Scythians, Arabs, and everyone else, while they continue on their merry path, worshiping stars and whatever else they come up with, he begins to intelligently form the people of Israel to receive the Master, the Rabbi, the Christ, the Messiah. And he prepares them over the period, as we said, 15 centuries. Then when the Messiah comes, Israel is meant to receive him and become the heralds of the announcement of the gospel for the rest of humanity, for all the other nations. And that is why the people in Rome are perplexed as to why this hasn't happened. Besides the question of just everyone's free, of course. And as we mentioned, thousands. We know on Pentecost Sunday, we're told in the Acts of the Apostles, that 3,000 people are baptized. So clearly there are thousands upon thousands of Jews who do enter and embrace the gospel and enter the new Israel, which is destined for all of mankind. And yet Israel as a recognized body doesn't. And this is still about 10 or 12 years before the destruction of Jerusalem. And that we're going to talk about on Wednesday evening in greater depth. And so this question that is asking, Paul has explained to him, yes, there was a preparation. But the foundation of the triune God's desire to bring all mankind into the healing of the gospel. And always remember, that is the purpose of the gospel and the divine mysteries. They are to heal us. They do make us good by grace. But the purpose is not to make us upright citizens who pay their taxes on time. A lot of times in the last 200 years since the French Revolution, the defense of Christianity is about making law-abiding citizens. That's not the reason why God entered the world. God entered the world to bring healing and integration and a restoration of what the human race was meant to be originally. Because if you fall upon the argument, well, Christianity is a good thing and we should keep it because it makes us law-abiding citizens. Well, you get the obvious result now 200 years later. I can be an upright citizen because my parents taught me well. I don't need the gospel to pay my taxes on time. And so that argument has fallen completely upon its face. Now, having said that, understand that morality does flow from the gospel. That we'll deal with later on. But it's important to understand the medicinal aspect of redemption, which cannot be gained from anything else except by the divine mysteries of the gospel. That is the mercy of God. And when we are healed, we can walk and we think clearly. When we are sick, we lay on that bed, drooling, puking up, and excreting and leaking everywhere. And our minds don't think clearly because we're sick. We lay there groaning and we try to sleep. That is the woundedness of the human race. But grace is medicinal to heal us and to make us whole as we were in the garden. And it's that understanding of mercy that's taking place here. So that what St. Paul says is, yes, Israel has been disobedient. And he says in the epistle today, they are positively in opposition to the gospel. That is true. And now the gospel is being spread to you. Remember the path, read the Acts of the Apostles, and remember the path of how the gospel is preached. The apostles would arrive at a town, and they would go to the synagogue. They would go to the synagogue Saturday after Saturday. They would be there, and they would explain the prophets. And they would explain the coming of the Messiah. And inevitably, at some point, whether weeks later or months later, there would be some who would believe that Jesus is the Messiah, and others who would refuse it. And then there would be this opposition. And St. Paul then would, as it's described, shake the dust off the bottom of his sandals and tell them, now that you have rejected this announcement of these good tidings, this gospel, we now turn to the Gentiles. And the gospel is preached to the Gentiles without Israel being heralded. And so St. Paul is writing to the Romans saying, yes, it is true. You have received the gospel. Israel, for the moment, is disobedient. Because the vision that continues from St. Paul, what he announces, he's saying, is that Israel remains disobedient until the fullness of the Gentiles come into the church. But in another letter, he will write about how the Gentiles themselves will fall away in apostasy. Remember, the word apostasis in Greek means divorce, separate apart from. So apostasy means we reject religion. That's apostasy. And he says in the letter, there will be a time. We now live in these last days of the moment that the nations of the earth, Asia, Africa, the Americas, and Europe, everyone is to be invited into this gospel to receive this healing of the human race. And he says that there will come a time when those nations will apostatize themselves from the gospel. I think I mentioned to you that St. Pius X, the Pope at the beginning of the 20th century, in 1906, 1908, he asked in one of his letters, his encyclicals, he asked, or elocutions, he asked the questions rhetorically, are we not in the beginning of the days of the apostasy of the nations? 1908. Because he could read in principle what was taking place in Europe and the Western world. So St. Paul says that yes, Israel for this moment is disobedient. And they are, because of that, enemies of the gospel. He doesn't hem around. He simply says, yes, they are enemies. They stand in opposition. They imprison me. They try to kill me. But because of the patriarchs, because of the prophets, because of their ancestors in Israel, they still remain chosen and the elect. Because God's choices are irrevocable. But the vision is that while all of humanity limped along, wounded for all those centuries, and then Israel was formed by an act of God's mercy, and in Israel herself as a nation failed, the gospel continues to spread its medicinal redemption. But he says, in the end, Israel will be saved. And that's mostly in chapter 10, which I encourage you to read. But he talks about the fact that Israel, at a point in history, will be provoked to emulation. And in reading St. Paul's letters, what it seems to indicate is that Israel will prepare for a Messiah. But that Christ will not be the Christ of redemption, but the Antichrist. And that preparation for that Messiah coming will lead them to their disillusionment in seeing what takes place through him. And then that will be the complete pivoting of Israel towards the gospel, once they have received as a nation the false Messiah. And again, we're talking about the recognition of the people, not every individual person. And he says, if Israel's infidelity has been for you, Gentiles, you pagans previously, has been a blessing, then what will Israel's fidelity be, if nothing else, the resurrection of the dead? And so that's why he comes to the end of this mystery to explain this trajectory of human history. Because he says, I don't want you to be wise in your own conceits, coming up with your own ideas of how God desires mankind and what is going to happen in human history. That's why the epistle begins that way today. So I'm going to tell you this mystery. And so in telling us this story, and reminding us from the prophecies of Isaiah, which is the quotation that you have in the epistle today, he's reminding us that God does this and allows free people to make choices. Because providence directs us according to our nature, and our nature is to be intelligent and to be free. We are conscious and free beings. And he leads us by that freedom, which means that we can always rebel. We can always sin. We can always apostatize. But he says in this vision then that Israel received mercy for a time. And they have rejected it now. And you Gentiles now have been grafted on to the old Israel, making the new Israel destined to last until the end of time. But he says that while you received mercy by the gospel from your paganism, so Israel is also going to receive the mercy of God from its infidelity and opposition to the Messiah and the gospel. And therefore, God will join everyone up in this single act of mercy. Everyone receives mercy. If Israel had been faithful to their path, who knows? As heralds, it had been the leading of actually the spread of the gospel 2,000 years ago. Would they have known the mercy that they had received? Or would they still have judged that somehow it was due to them? We don't know. But God allowed them to be disobedient, so that he can also grant them mercy the same way he grants mercy to the pagans, and brings them all together unto one single act of God by his divine mercy. So that what St. Paul is saying in this chapters 9, 10, and 11 is that God's salvation, this healing and reintegration of human beings in the divine economy, moves forward despite man's rebellion. God is always in charge. And we either line up under God's mercy or we line up under God's justice. One of the two. But God will always be the winner in the end because it's his creation. And so St. Paul says, I know that this is overwhelming for you to think about this kind of human level of history. And he finishes this epistle by saying, So these also now have not believed for your sake, for your mercy, that they may also in the future obtain mercy. For God has abandoned all in unbelief that he may have mercy on all. And that's why those last three lines of the epistle is in a literary form, St. Paul is prostrate before the divine majesty of who can know the riches and the depth and the wisdom of God in accomplishing all these things throughout all of the human race across the planet. Who is his counselor? Who has given to God? God has given us everything. And so this profound act of adoration to God, then reflected in that Trinitarian image, which is why it's chosen for this Sunday of the Holy Trinity, that from him and through him and for him are all things. That we thank God that we have been brought into this Trinitarian life by grace, by mercy, and by compassion. To him be glory forever. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.